Hello everyone, welcome to the Enterprise Integrator Webinar Series 2020. I'm Sachit Karunathilaka and I have Sajitha Lienage here with me from WSO2 integration team. Today's webinar will focus on implementing a CI/CD pipeline with WSO2 Enterprise Integrator. Before we get started, let's look at the agenda for the day. In this webinar, firstly, we will be discussing the requirement of a CI/CD process in business platforms and the burden of traditional disconnected experience. Secondly, this webinar will focus on how WSO2 Enterprise Integrator can be used to implement a connected developer experience. And finally, we will be demonstrating you with building a CI/CD pipeline with our integrator server. Before moving on to the CI/CD part, let's see why agility is an important aspect in modern business platforms. Agility refers how fast a process can make changes to its existing state. As we all know, modern business environment is highly dynamic and keeps on changing rapidly. New requirements arise along with new best practices. Businesses should be able to respond rapidly to these changes in order to maintain their competitive advantage. Another important factor is that agile processes allow developers to incrementally develop their software, which leads to improved quality in the long run. Now let's see how WSO2 Enterprise Integrated Server can be incorporated to create a CI/CD pipeline. WSO2 facilitates CI/CD process implementation with its many products. In the case of Enterprise Integrator, the two main tools involved in this implementation are the Integration Studio and the Micro Integrator. Integration Studio is used to develop integration scenarios easily and intuitively. Micro Integrator is an integration server that helps you integrate microservices and cloud-native enterprise architectures using a configuration-driven approach. Okay, here we have an overview of the CI/CD pipeline we will be implementing today. Any CI/CD pipeline begins with development. We will be using WSO2 Integration Studio for this stage of the pipeline. After the development phase, we will be committing these artifacts to a common location, thus allowing collaboration. Tools such as GitHub and SVN can be used for this stage of the pipeline. Upon committing these changes, we'll be moving on to the continuous integration stage where we retrieve artifacts from the source repository. Tools such as Jenkins and Travis CI can be used for this purpose. Finally, we'll be deploying the built artifacts into the production environment, thus completing our pipeline. Now let's have a closer look at the development stage of the CI/CD pipeline. Any software project has five common stages in its life cycle, namely design, develop, test, debug, and deploy. WSO2 Integration Studio offers many capabilities to execute these stages with ease and a connected experience. Let us now explain how WSO2 Integration Studio provides you with a connected developer experience in the development stage of our pipeline. Development is the first stage of any software development lifecycle. Integration Studio provides you with an intuitive graphical user interface to develop your integration scenarios. It provides you with multiple types of projects based on your requirement. The most common project types include ESP config projects, composite application projects, connect exporter projects, registry source projects, and Docker and Kubernetes exporter projects. Within these projects, you can develop your integration scenarios either using predefined mediators or also even by exporting connectors. Moving on to the testing phase. Testing is facilitated by the unit test framework in the Integration Studio, which allows you to test the implemented flows and then build a CI/CD pipeline. It also allows you to create mock backend services for testing. We'll be showing you how you can do this in the demonstration part of our webinar. Integration Studio allows error correction using its inbuilt debugger. You can debug the integration flow either in the embedded microintegrator server we are providing or even with a remote server. It also allows you to add different servers for our debugging purposes. After developing and testing your integration scenario, now it's time that you deploy them. Integration Studio has four inbuilt mechanisms to do this deployment process. Namely, you can use the car deployer plugin, generate a Docker image and then deploy this, deploying into a remote server, or you can deploy to the integration cloud. However, in today's webinar, we will not be showing you the inbuilt deployment capabilities of our Integration Studio, but rather we'll be showing you how you can deploy your application using a Jenkins pipeline to a VM and a Kubernetes environment. Okay. Now let's move on to the sample use case, which we will be demonstrating in the next part of this webinar. This is the use case we'll be implementing during the demonstration. Ideally, the requirement is to expose an existing legacy SOAP service, which is used to make airline reservations as a RESTful API. Invoking this API should ideally result in three tasks. First, it should communicate with the legacy airline SOAP service to make a reservation. Secondly, it should create a file with the reservation information. And finally, forward the response from the legacy system back to the client. Here you can see an abstract overview of interactions between the legacy system and our RESTful API. Now that you have a clear idea of what our use case is, let's get started with the demonstration, which will be conducted by Sajitha. Sajitha, you can move on with the demonstration.
Yeah, so we have recorded the screencast for this demonstration. So let's see how we can implement and deploy this scenario via the CI/CD pipeline using our WSO2 Enterprise Integrator and WSO2 Integration Studio. So let me first start the Integration Studio. So this is our getting started page of the Integration Studio. So to start with our scenario, let's create a Maven multi-module project. So with my Maven multi-module project, we can manage multiple projects as the its modules. So let me name the group ID of the project as airline.reservation and the artifact ID also as the airline reservation project. So once we click finish, the Maven multi-module project will create inside the Integration Studio. So let's create an ESP config project. So with this ESP config project, we can create Synapse artifacts for our scenarios. So let me name the project first. Airline reservation project, then we can finish it. So now you can see we have created a ESP config project inside the our Maven multi-module project. So so here we are using a REST API to develop our scenario. Let me create an API first. Let me name it as airline reservation and the context is reservation. Let me finish it. So now we have created the API inside our ESB config project. So in this API, we can have multiple resources. So by default, we have created the one resource. So we can add the URL template for this resource. Let me edit it as a new, because first we are going to create an API resource for creating a new reservation from this API. So after that, let me add a log mediator to log the incoming message. So here I am using a custom log. So therefore I can create a custom block from this view. So I can give a property name, also the property value here. So after that, I can finish it. So now we have add the log mediator first in our resource path. Then let me add the clone mediator after the log mediator. So basically here we are using a clone mediator to clone the incoming mediator flow. In this case, we are using two mediation flows. Therefore, we need to add two branches in this clone mediator. So first case first branch is used for the calling backend legacy backend airline reservation system, and another branch is for creating a file inside the file system as we demonstrated in our scenario diagram. So let's move into the first use case. This use case is for calling the legacy backend of the airline reservation system. So here I will add a data mapper mediator first, because our incoming message is in JSON format, but our legacy legacy backend is not supported, doesn't support it for the JSON format. Therefore, we need to do a data transformation here to JSON to XML. For that reason, we can use this data mapper mediator to transform the incoming data formats to our own format. So here I will add the data mapper. To save the data mapper configuration, first we have to have a registry project inside our Maven multimodule project. So let me create a new registry project to save the data mapper configurations first. So I will name it as airline reservation registry. So once I create this project, so I can save the data mapper configurations inside this registry project. So once we create the project, so this is the view for the data mapper. So in this data mapper, we can select the input schema, also the output schema. So in our scenario, our input schema, the resource type is JSON, and we can give a schema based on our incoming message. So this is our JSON schema, and we want to transform this JSON schema to the XML. Therefore, our output is a type is XML, and this is my output XML schema. Then I can map my input to output by linking them. So now we have finished this data mapping process. We are using this data mapper mediator. So now we can add call mediator after the data mapper mediator to invoke the legacy backend with the transformed message. So here I have already defined the legacy server backend as an endpoint. So I can drag that endpoint into the call mediator. So now the data mapper will transform our incoming JSON payload to XML, and call mediator will call to the legacy backend with the transform message, and it will get the response from the legacy backend. So to response back, we can add the response mediator after the call mediator. So it will response the incoming payload from this legacy backend to the client via this response mediator. So now we have done with the use case number one to invoke the legacy server backend and create a new reservation. So let's move into the second use case. This use case is for creating a file inside our file system. So to do that, we have to have two properties inside our mediation flow. So to do that, we can add the property group mediator first. Inside the property group mediator, we can create multiple properties. So let me first create a property for property name as a payload and its expression type. So in this payload, I will save the body of the message. So it this payload contains the incoming message body. So let me create another property name called source URL. So this is the property that contains the file name. So I can use this concat function to create a name for this file. So file, actually the file name should be the path for that file and also the unique name. So this is the location I am going to save this file. And inside the airline reservation, I will create a folder called reservation and the reservation file. So we have to give a unique name here. Therefore, I can use system time, system date property to get a unique name for this file. So this expression gives the unique name for this file to this file, and it will save property as the source URL. Now we have created the two properties in this mediation flow, one for the payload and another for the source URL. So let me first add the file connector to create a file in this mediation flow. We can use the WSO2 connector store to download the file connector from there. So here I have downloaded the file connector from the connector store. So once we download that, we can choose the file connector mediators from the palette, as you can see now. So here we can use the create mediator to create a file inside our file system. So inside this create mediator, we can point out our existing two properties as a source and the as an input content. So here source is the content of the file. So this should be the property we have created, payload. So we can just type as CTX, so source URL. So here source means the file name, and the input content is the payload. So here I will use the property called payload. Now we have configured the file create mediator successfully. So after that, we no need to mediate the second use case furthermore. Therefore, we can add the job mediator to drop the mediation flow in the second use case. So this is the source view of our API. So we have add the log mediator first, and then we have add the clone mediator with two branches. So inside two branches, we have configured our integration solution as we expected and as we described in our diagram. So let's create a connect exporter project first. Then here with this connect exporter project, we can export our file connector to the deployment stage. So let me name the exporter project as airline reservation connectors. And after that, we can add the downloaded connector to this exporter project. And then we can here you can see the file connector added to the exporter project successfully. After that, we can create a composite project inside our Maven multi-module project to deploy our artifacts into the runtime as a car application. Let me name the project as airline reservation composite. Then we can select the, all the dependencies in here and finish the project creation. So now you can see our in our Maven multi-module project, we have a ESP config project, composite project, connector exporter project, and the registry project. So before we are going to deploy this, we can test run and see our scenario is working as expected. So to do that, we can right click on our composite project and run our scenario with the embedded micro integrator inside the integration studio. Once we finish this wizard, so the embedded micro integrator will run. And you can see the logs of the micro integrator in the console. Let me invoke and see it's working as expected or not. So here, this is our URL. The reservation is our context and new is a resource name. And this is our payload. And once we invoke this URL, you can see we got our response as expected. Also, the file has been created successfully in our given location. Also, the content of the incoming message also include in that file. Now it's time to create a unit test for our integration artifacts. To do that, we can use the unit testing framework inside this integration studio. So to do that, we can just right click on our artifacts and create a unit test. So in here, we have to give a name for the test suite. Let me name as an airline reservation test suite. And here we can select what are the supportive artifacts to that particular test case. Here I am going to test the API. So inside the API, I am using some endpoints and also the registry configurations. Therefore, I need to select those things. And here we can create a mock service for our existing integration flow. So my plan is to create a mock service for the legacy backend. Therefore, I will create a new mock service from this wizard. So let me give a name for this mock service. And here I can give the actual name of the endpoint I am going to mock. So that means if you are going to mock any endpoint, you have to give that actual name of the endpoint as the value of mocking endpoint name. Then we can give some port to start this mock service and also the context. Here I will use the reservation/new context for this mock service. With this plus icon, we can add multiple sub resources to this mock service. Here, I'm not going to add multiple sub resources. Therefore, I will only add one sub context. And here we can, if you want to mock a service based on the incoming request also, you can configure your mock service from this wizard. So this is the expected response from the mock service. Here I need get the 200 status code. Also, this is my expected response body from this mock service. Therefore, after we configure this information, we can create this mock service. Then I can select this mock service via this unit testing wizard and create a unit test suite for my given API. So once we create the unit test suite, you can see the unit test suite has been created inside the test directory. Also, the mock service has been created inside the mock services folder. And this is the view for the unit testing suite. The unit testing suite has three sections. The first section has the details of what is the main test artifact and also the test cases. And in the second section includes the details of what are the supportive artifacts for this mock service, unit test. And also in third section, the mock service detail section, it tells the what are the mock services we are using this for this unit test suite. So from this plus icon, we can add multiple test cases for this particular test suite. Let me add a test case for this test suite. I will name it as new reservation because there is only one resource in this API, and that resource name is slash new, and we are using a post method to invoke that API. So this is my input payload, and the input payload has one input property, that's a content type property. So with this input properties, we can add headers also to invoke this API via the unit testing server. So I will add the content type property with the value of application JSON, because in our input payload, the input payload type is JSON format. The type is in JSON format. So in the assertion section, we can add multiple assertion for a particular test case. So here test case assertion types can be either assert equals or assert not null. So here I am going to assert my API response body with my expected value. So this is my expected value from this test case. And I'm going to assert my expected value from the server response. So if the server response is not equal to the expected value, we can have an error message to print in the logs of the unit testing summary. So here now I have added one assertion, and I can add this test case into our test suite and save the file. So now I have configured my unit testing suite successfully. I have added what is the main test artifact and what are the supportive artifacts and what are the test cases, also the what are the mock services. Once we configured this, then we can run this unit test suite via the embedded micro integrator inside the Integration Studio. Also here we can choose if you want to run with this test suite with the remote server. Also we can choose the remote server configuration option to do that. So at the moment I will choose the local server configuration option to run this unit test suite with embedded micro integrator. So here you can see unit test is now running, and my test case now has passed. It shows the deployment, mediation, and assertion. All the mediation phases are passed. So now we have created three main projects inside our Maven multimodule project. So let's move to the GitHub and create a new repository for our integration solution. So here we are using GitHub as a collaborative tool to share the code bases among the developers. So once we create this repository in the GitHub, we can push our integration solution to this GitHub repository. We can add all the changes via the git add command. And give a commit message here. Then we can push these changes to our created GitHub repository. So once we refresh this GitHub repository, you can see now we have our ESB config project, composite project, connector project, and the register project in our GitHub repository. So let's move to deploying our integration solution into in VM environment. To do that, first let's move into the Jenkins. So with the Jenkins, we can create jobs to automate the CI/CD pipeline. So in Jenkins, we can create a job called development to build our integration solution from this job. From the Git section, we can add our GitHub repository URL here. And the build, here we will use the top level Maven target. So here I'm going to create this job for build the integration solution. Therefore, we can use clean install without test cases command. That means Maven clean install minus D Maven test skip equals 2. From this command, it will build the integration solution in our ESB config project. Let me save and create this job. Then we can create another job for the testing purposes. Let's name it as test. And as in previous, here also we have to point to our GitHub repository. And here, the Maven top level Maven target is Maven test. But to run the unit testing framework, we have to add some additional parameters as well. So as additional parameters, there are some additional parameters like test server type. Here the server types can be a local or remote. So local means we can run the these test cases with the some micro integrator or enterprise integrator server. To do that, we can just point that server with the test server path property. So this is my micro integrator in this server, and I can point this micro integrator with this test server path property. Also, I need to point the unit testing port. Therefore, I can add minus D test server port as 9008 here. So from this command, it will run the unit testing framework in 9008 port. So here I have added the test server type, test server path, and the test server port to run the unit testing framework. And let me apply and save this job. So now we have created the two jobs. First one for the development to build our integration artifacts, and second one for run the test cases we have written for our artifacts. Then let me create another job to deploy this in the VM environment. So as in previous, here also we have to point our GitHub URLs as a repository URL. And here, the build action is a execute shell command. This is our shell command we are using to deploy the integration solution in the VM environment. So it will kill all the services running 80-90 port, and it will copy our composite application, which is car apps, into the server carbon apps directory. Then it will run the micro integrator server by running the micro integrator sh file. So these are the three jobs we have created in the Jenkins. Now it's time to create a build pipeline for these jobs. So let me name this at airline reservation project and select this build pipeline view. So in this build pipeline, we have to give the initial job for in here, we our initial job is development, because the development job should trigger first. And let me apply and create this pipeline. And after that, we need to change these jobs. So this test job should trigger after the development job triggered and passed successfully. Therefore, here we need to add the development job as a build trigger of this test job. And in the development job, it should need to trigger after the test job. Then here we can add the test job as the build trigger of this deployment job. So now we have changed these jobs and we have configured this pipeline also. Now let's run this pipeline and see how it deploy the microintegrator inside the VM environment. So first it will run the development job, and you can see the artifacts have built successfully, and it will run the unit test suits in our integration solution project, and finally it will deploy our integration solution inside the microintegrator, and it will start the microintegrator. So let's invoke and see our API is working with the VM environment. So you can see as we expected, the deployed API is running as expected in VM environment. So let's move to deploying Kubernetes. So to deploy in Kubernetes, we have to add another separate project to this our Maven multi-module project. So here we can use Kubernetes Exporter project to deploy our integration solutions inside the Kubernetes environment. So first, let me name this project. And in here it by default, the Kubernetes Exporter project will create a file called integration CRML file. So in this wizard, we have to give some details to create that integration CRML file. So I will explain why we need this integration CRML file for our Kubernetes deployment in later. So here I can give a integration name. So this name will be used inside our Kubernetes deployment. And here we can point how many replicas do we need to deploy in Kubernetes, and what is your base image we are going to use to build this Docker image with our integration solution. And in this target image repository, we can point what is the Docker image name we are going to create with this integration studio. So here I will use sajagima/airline-reservation as my Docker image name, and I will give the tag image tag as 100. So this is it. So we can just click finish and create this Ktest exporter project inside the integration studio. So in the right hand side also, you can see there is a some user guide to how to build a Docker image by using this Kubernetes Exporter project. Also how to deploy the our integration solution into the Kubernetes. Likewise, we can get some additional detail from this user guide. So this is the view for this Kubernetes Exporter project. So in this project, you can see there is a lib directory, resource directory also. So those details you can refer by from this user guide. And in this Kubernetes Exporter project, there is a section called dependencies. So in this dependencies section, we can select multiple carbon composite applications, which means Kubernetes apps, to include our Docker image, which we are going to build within this Exporter project. So here in this case, I have only one composite project. That means airline reservation composite. So I will select that one and save the POM file. And let's move into the integration CRML file. So this integration CRML file has a special kind called integration. So in this YAML file, we have point out how many replicas do we need to deploy this YAML file. Also, what is our Docker image to use this deployment. So before we are going to deploy our scenario into the Kubernetes, first we need to build and push our Docker image to the relevant Docker registry. To do that, we can follow two ways. Just right click on the Kubernetes export project and choose the build and push Docker image option, or just click build and push option in the pom.xml file. So once we click that one, we can just, in this wizard, we have to give the credential for our Docker registry. So here, if you are using, you can use Docker Hub or relevant Docker registry. If you are using a Docker registry except to the Docker Hub, you have to give the registry URL in here. For this scenario, I will use my Docker Hub account. So here I have to give my Docker Hub credentials. Once I give my Docker Hub credentials, the Integration Studio will build a Docker image with our integration solution and push that Docker image to the Docker Hub repository as we given in the target repository name. So you can see the Docker image has built and now it's in the process of pushing the Docker image to the Docker Hub. So this is my airline reservation Docker repository. So at the moment, there is no any tags. So now Docker image has pushed the Docker image into the Docker registry as successfully. So once I refresh this Docker repository, you can see now there is a one tag called 1.00. So this is my integration solution. So now we can push our created Docker Kubernetes exporter project also to the GitHub. We can use git add command to add our Kubernetes exporter project and give a commit message. Then we can push our Kubernetes exporter project using a git push command. So once we refresh this GitHub account, you can see now we can see our Kubernetes exporter project also inside this our WSO2 CI/CD demo GitHub repository. Now let's move into the Jenkins again. So in here, also we can use this development and test jobs as we use in the VM environment for the Kubernetes deploying Kubernetes environment too, because the development job does is it will build the artifacts in our integration solution, and in the test job, what the test job does is it will run the test suites inside our integration solution. So these two jobs will common for both VM and Kubernetes environment deployments. So additionally, we can create another job named Docker build to build the Docker image with our integration solution. As in previous cases, here also we can point our GitHub repository as a GitHub URL. And here the build trigger should be the test job, because after the test job is done, then this Docker build job should execute. And here, this also the top level maven target. In this goal, should be the build only the Kubernetes exporter project. So once we run this command inside the Kubernetes exporter project, so it will build the Kubernetes Explorer project and build a Docker image in local. So now, before moving to the create a Kubernetes deployment job, let me introduce our new operator called the KTS EI operator, which is used for deploy integration solution in Kubernetes. So what the operator does is it will automate the deployment process in Kubernetes for our integration solution. So it will create pods, services, ingresses for us using this integration CRYAML file, what I have explained in the previous case. So it will automate the deployment process inside the Kubernetes. So first we have to install this Kubernetes EI operator in our Kubernetes cluster. We can follow this documentation to do that. So this is a one-time requirement. After we install this KTS EI operator in Kubernetes, then we can apply that integration CRYAML file inside the Kubernetes cluster. So once we apply that integration CRYAML file, so operator will recognize that kind call integration from that integration CRYAML file, then it will automate the deployment process inside the Kubernetes with our integration solution. So you can refer more details about this KTS EI operator by referring our KTS and Kubernetes and Docker Native Patterns webinar series. So once we install this operator, we can just check that by executing the kubectl getpods command. So here we have installed the Kubernetes operator in Kubernetes successfully. Now let's move into Jenkins and create a new job for deployment in Kubernetes. So let me name it as Kubernetes deploy. And here also we need to point our GitHub repository as a repository URL in Git section. And this build trigger should be the Docker build, because if the Docker build happens successfully, we can trigger this KTS deploy job. And here we can use the shell command to build this job. We can move into our Kubernetes Explorer project and push the Docker image to the relevant Docker registry by passing the registry credentials. So here we can use the maven docker push command with the parameters of username and the password. So with this build command, it will push the build docker image to the Docker registry with this username and password credentials. Then we can add the post build action to this job. So if the Docker push happens successfully, we can apply this integration CRYAML file inside the Kubernetes cluster. Therefore, we can move into our KTS exporter project and apply our Kubernetes integration CRYAML file by using kubectl apply -f integration CRYAML file. And let me apply and save this job. For as you can see, in deploying Kubernetes, we have configured four jobs, one for development, another one for testing, another one for build the Docker image, and finally, the job for deploying Kubernetes. So let me create a pipeline for these jobs. So this pipeline will be used in the Kubernetes deployment. let me name it as Airline Reservation Kubernetes Project and choose the build pipeline view option. And here also my initial job is development. And here we have changed our jobs. Then we can run this build pipeline to see what will happen within this build pipeline. So it will first trigger the development job, and it will build our integration solution. That means it will build our ESB config project. Then we can see it builds the test job, and you can see the logs from this console. Then it builds the Docker build job, and it will build the Docker image in locally. And finally, the K-test deploy job will push the Docker image to the relevant Docker registry and apply the integration CRAML file inside the Kubernetes. So after that, we can just run the kubectl get pods command to verify our deployment. Here you can see we have an additional pod inside the Kubernetes called airline reservation deployment. That means the operator does the deployment inside the Kubernetes. Here also you can see with the kubectl get services, we have a service for this deployment, and kubectl get ingress, we have an ingress for this deployment. So before going to the invoke this service, we have to add this WSO2EI host name inside the ECT host file. To do that, we have to get Minikube IP here, because I am using the Minikube as my Kubernetes cluster. Then I can add this Minikube IP against the WSO2EI host name. Once I save it, then now I will able to invoke this API inside the Kubernetes to get the response as we expected. This is the URL pattern we have to follow to invoke the API inside the Kubernetes. So first, the WSO2EI is the host name, and the airline reservation is my integration name. After that, we have to add this hyphen service. After that, we can add the context of the API as we use in the local machine. And this is my input payload. Once I invoke this API, so you can see we can get the response from the Kubernetes API as we expected. So let's see an additional thing as extending the requirement. So here, previously we are using this API to create a new reservation. So now we have a additional requirement to update the existing reservation. So to do that, we have to modify our existing API to have a additional resource. Here we can add the API resource to our existing API and add the URL template as update. So this this resource also has a method of post and get rest methods. So let me add the log mediator first in this resource also to log a custom message. Let me name this as airline reservation and the property value as update airline reservation. So once we add the log mediator, we can add the payload factory mediator to construct the payload to invoke the legacy update update backend service. So here we can use the payload factory mediator. So we can construct the payload by getting the values from incoming message. So this is my payload. So in this payload, we have to add some arguments based on the incoming message. Those are indicated by the dollar marks. So we can, in this view, we can add the arguments these are based on the incoming message. So here I will give some XPaths for the incoming message to get those arguments value to this payload tracking mediator. So likewise, we can construct this payload via the payload factory mediator. And after that, we can use the call mediator to call the update reservation service. Therefore, I can add the call mediator, and inside the call mediator, I can add the already created legacy update reservation SOAP backend. And after that, we can add response mediator to get the response from this new resource. So now we have configured the new resource in our existing API. So after we create our integration artifacts, then we have to add that change artifacts in our composite application, as well as we have to update our Kubernetes exporter project POM file, also the integration CRML file. So here I will upgrade my Docker image target tag as a 110. So it will create a new Docker image inside my repository with the tag name called 110. And in the integration CRML file also, I have to change that URL as image path as 110. So let me save these files, and then after that we can push these changes to the Docker to the GitHub. We can use git add command to add the changes and give a commit message using git commit. And finally, we can use git push command to push our changes to the GitHub repository. And in this case, developer doesn't need to worry about the deployment of our new solution inside the Kubernetes, because we have set up our build pipeline in Jenkins. So we can just run this build pipeline to deploy our new solution inside the Kubernetes. So here you can see it will build our integration solution first, and then it will run our test suites, and then it will build the Docker image, and in the K-test deploy job, it will push the new Docker image to the Docker registry and apply the integration CRML file into the Kubernetes environment. Then we can execute and verify our new deployment with the Kubernetes cluster. So here our new reservation resource was update. So this is my payload. And once I invoke this API, you can see I got my response as expected. So that's all about the demonstration. So Sachit.
Yes, Sajid. Thank you for your concise demonstration. So now that we are done with the demonstration, let's recap what we discussed today. So as we mentioned earlier, agility plays a vital role in maintaining a competitive advantage in business scenarios. As we like we mentioned previously, there are new best practices and new requirements keep arising all the time, and CI/CD is the pathway to achieving this agility. WSO to enterprise integrator allows the end user to easily integrate with external platforms to create CI/CD pipelines. Okay, so now that we have concluded our demonstration, we can move on to our question and answering session. So if you have any questions that you would like to ask us, please do direct them to us, and we'll try as much as possible to answer all your questions. Okay. Okay, now I have received one question here. Basically, okay, it says, how can I maintain artifacts in different environments within a CI/CD flow? Okay, so with this question, I believe here you are referring to how you can manage your Synapse configurations between different environments. In that case, with EI Enterprise Integrator 650 and MI110 onwards, we have introduced environmental variable support for our products. With this, instead of directly defining environment-specific configs such as endpoint URLs, we can set environment variables in a specific environment and then refer them in your Synapse configuration. So there we have already published documentation on this matter, and hope I provided the answer you were looking for. So are there any other questions? Okay, so I've received another question here. It says, in the demonstration, you have created a test suite for your Synapse configuration. Does it mean we can write tests to cover all Synapse artifacts? Well, currently, at the moment, the test suite only facilitates APIs, proxies, sequences in HTTP and HTTPS transports. So, no. Yeah, those are the only things the test suite covers. So it seems we are receiving quite more than receiving many more questions than we have anticipated, but we have already run out of time, unfortunately. So what we can do is we will mail you with the answers for all your questions, and now we will conclude our session. Hope you enjoyed it, and make sure you register for all our upcoming webinars as well. Thank you.
Thank you.